Okay, I hope I'm audible to all students who are attending this lecture of public economics. We continue with our lectures on theories of the public sector. Okay, we continue with our lectures on theories of the public sector. Okay, and the reading I prefer to follow for my lectures on theories of the public sector, this is by Hendricks and Miles. Okay, now all students can recall that in the previous lecture of theories of the public sector, we were doing the Wagner's law. We had also done the Baumol's law in the previous lecture. Okay, now in this particular lecture, we intend to look at a political model for discussing the size of the public sector. Okay, so we are going to focus in this particular lecture on a political model. Okay, so this model of the public sector expenditure captures the conflict that arises in the public preferences between those who wish to have higher expenditure and those who wish to limit the burden of the taxes. All of us know that when deciding what should be the desired level of the public sector expenditure, there's always a conflict, because if you require higher public expenditure, for that you need to pay higher taxes. It cannot be the case that you are having higher public expenditure and at the same time you're paying lower taxes. That is not possible. If you want the public sector to do more expenditure, for that you need to pay higher taxes. So there is a conflict in the public preferences, because some of the people, they wish to have higher expenditure, but at the same time they wish to limit the burden of the taxes. So basically, the political model is going to tell us what should be the desired level of the public sector expenditure. Because if you look at the preferences of the public, they are conflicting. They desire a higher level of public expenditure, but they want to limit the burden of the taxes at the same time. Okay, so this model must also incorporate the resolution of this conflict and show how the size and composition of actual public spending reflect the preferences of the majority of citizens as expressed through the political process. So this model will be using some math and optimization to show what should be the optimum level or the desired level of public spending. And that in turn is going to show the preferences of majority of citizens as expressed through the political process. Okay, so let's look at the microeconomics of this model. Okay, so let's go deeper into the model now. Consider an economy. It consists of H consumers whose income falls in the range between a minimum of zero and a maximum of Y hat. So the population consists of H consumers and their income falls between zero and Y hat. Okay. The government provides a public good that is financed by the use of a proportional income tax. That means those who avail the benefits from this public good have to pay the proportional income tax. So when you pay the proportional income tax to the government uses that money to provide the public good to you. Very simple. I again repeat, when you pay the proportional income tax to the government uses that tax revenue to provide the public good. Okay. The utility of consumer I, whose income YI is given by, so you can see, all students can see the utility function on your screen. UI, which is a function of the proportional tax, and the public good G is equal to 1 minus P times YI plus B as a function of G. Obviously, since you are paying the proportional tax P of your income to the government, what is your disposable income left after paying the tax? 1 minus T times YI. Plus B as a function of G denotes the benefit you receive from the provision of the public good. Okay, you can clearly see where T is the income tax rate and G is the level of the public good provision. the benefit function. So B represents the benefit from the public good and is assumed to be increasing. That means your marginal benefit B dash G is positive and concave. Concave means the marginal benefit is increasing, but at a decreasing rate. The marginal benefit is positive, but decreasing. That means what? That means as your public good provision increases, you derive more benefit from it, but at a decreasing rate. So till now, I can sum it up on the whiteboard quickly. Okay. We are looking at the political model for public good provision. And this model is going to show us what? This model is going to give us the desired level of the public good. It is going to give us the desired level of the public good given the conflict in the public preferences. Given the conflict in the public preferences between those who wish to have higher expenditure, those who wish to have higher expenditure, and those who wish to limit the burden of the taxes. Okay, so this model is going to tell us that given that in the public, there's a conflict in the preferences because some of them want higher expenditure, higher public expenditure, and some of them want to limit the burden of the taxes. They are conflicting. Why are they conflicting? Because to have higher expenditure, you need to pay higher taxes. So this model is going to tell us then what should be the desired level of the public good given that both these preferences of the public are conflicting each other. Because the public wants higher expenditure on the public good, and at the same time, the public also wants to limit the burden of the taxes. Okay, so we quickly started with the model. The model was as follows. I'm quickly writing it. The population consists of H consumers whose incomes are between 0 and y hat. 0 is the minimum income, y hat is the maximum income. Okay. Then at the same time, T denotes the proportional income tax. T denotes the proportional income tax paid by the consumers for the provision of the public good G. For the provision of the public good capital G. Okay, so the utility of the ith consumer, which is a function of the proportional tax, and T is nothing but 1 minus T times YI. What is 1 minus T times YI? Disposable income after tax. When you pay a tax of T times YI to the government, what is the income left after this tax? 1 minus T times YI plus B as a function of G. This is nothing but benefit from the public good. Benefit from the public good provision. And we have discussed the properties of the function B as a function of G. B dash G is positive and B double dash G is negative. This means the benefit from the public good is increasing, but at a decreasing rate. This is B dash G. This is nothing but your marginal benefit. B dash G is nothing but your marginal benefit. You can clearly see that the marginal benefit is increasing, but at a decreasing rate. Okay, so if I move forward with the model, we can continue further. If I come back quickly to the lecture note, let's come back to the lecture note. So let mu denote the mean income level in the population of the consumers. Okay, so mu denotes the mean income. How do you find the mean income? Total income divided by total population. Okay, so guys, what will be the total income? If I write mean income is equal to total income divided by total population, then this implies what will my total income be? My total income will be equal to mean income into total population. My total income will be equal to mean income into total population. Now, what is my mean income? Mu. What is my total population? H consumers. So my total income is mu times H. And here we have the government budget constraint. Expenditure of the government should exactly be equal to the tax revenue of the government. Now, what's the tax revenue of the government? The tax of P collected on the income, the total income. This is nothing but my proportional tax. And this is nothing but my total income. And you can clearly see total income is nothing but mean income multiplied by the total population. So you can clearly see this is the budget constraint of the government, which tells us that total expenditure of the government should be equal to the total income earned by the government. Total income earned by the government is nothing but the proportional tax earned on the total income. So using this budget constraint, a consumer with the income YI will enjoy utility from the provision of a quantity G of the public good of the following. So basically, if I quickly recall, what was UI as a function of G? You can clearly see this was UI as a function of P and G, which is 1 minus T times YI plus B as a function of G. Okay, we put the value of P from here. So what is P? P is nothing but capital G upon H times mu. I put this value here. 1 minus P, where T is nothing but G upon H times mu times YI plus B, B as a function of G. So I get this utility function now purely in terms of G. If I come to the whiteboard, I can quickly explain this on the whiteboard as well. Okay, we had this equation. UI as a function of P and G was 1 minus P times YI plus B as a function of G. Now, the budget constraint of the government is, the total expenditure by the government should be equal to total income earned by the government, which is nothing but the proportional tax times the total income of the population, H times mu. So this implies what is P? G upon H times mu. Putting this value of P in equation star. Putting this value of P in equation star. I get UI as a function of G as 1 minus P is nothing but G by H mu times YI plus B as a function of G. Okay, now objective is what? Objective is to maximize this utility of the ith individual in the population. And what do we need to choose? We need to choose capital G. So first order condition. Del UI by del G equal to 0 implies if I partially differentiate the utility function with respect to G, what do I get? I get minus YI upon H times mu plus B dash G is equal to 0. And I can further write it as follows. So if I erase the initial part, how can I further write it? I can write it as, therefore, B dash G is equal to YI upon H mu. Okay, How can I interpret the above condition? So let's look at the interpretation. The above condition. The above condition relates the marginal benefit. The above condition relates the marginal benefit of an additional unit of the public good B dash G. This is nothing but my marginal benefit to its marginal cost. What's the marginal cost? Clearly in the above expression, the marginal cost is nothing but yi upon h times mu. That means the above condition, this condition tells us what? This condition tells us that that level of public good should be provided such that the marginal benefit received from the additional unit of the public good should exactly be equal to the marginal cost of its provision. B dash G denotes the marginal benefit, yi upon h times mu denotes the marginal cost. Okay, so if I quickly come back to the lecture note, okay, in the lecture note, we can quickly go through this again, makes it more clear. So this is our first order condition we get after partially differentiating. The above condition relates the marginal benefit, which is nothing but B dash G, to the marginal cost, which is yi by h mu. The quantity of the public good demanded by the consumer depends on their income relative to the mean. You can clearly see that the quantity of the public good which the consumer is going to demand is going to depend on its income yi. It is going to depend on its income yi relative to the mean. Yi is the income of the ith individual. This is the income of the ith individual, and mu is the mean income. Mu denotes the mean income. Okay, so all students can clearly see this, that the demand for the public good by the ith consumer, the demand of the public good by the ith consumer depends on the income of the ith individual relative to the mean income, as this is going to determine the marginal cost. We have seen that yi upon h times mu is nothing but my marginal cost. Okay, so clearly all students can also see this, that the marginal benefit of the public good has been assumed to be decreasing function of g. That means the double derivative b double dash g is negative. We said that the marginal benefit is positive, but it is increasing at a decreasing rate. That means it's concave. The marginal benefit function is concave. The marginal benefit function is concave. The double derivative b double dash g is negative. So it follows that the preferred public good level is decreasing as income rises. Okay, you can see this mathematically, guys. What was the condition? The condition was, if I come back to the lecture note, if I come back to the whiteboard, the condition we had just done was this. This was the condition. So all students can observe what? All students can observe. Okay, so you can clearly see that as income goes up, as income goes up, what happens? As income goes up, B double dash G also goes up. And when will B dash G go up? Remember, marginal benefit is going to rise only when, what happens? Marginal benefit, since B double dash G is negative, I can write, therefore, B dash G rises when G falls. So what can I say? I can say that the preferred public good level is decreasing as income goes up. It's a very important point to understand. Okay, I can explain this point again. Let me first of all erase this particular portion. Let me explain this point again for perfect clarity. Okay, what is this point telling us? I'm doing it again for all students. Okay, look at this particular condition on the screen. We had just done this condition. Now we want to see what happens as YI goes up. As YI, that means income of the ith individual. As income of the ith individual increases, this implies the right hand side, which is YI by H mu increases. This implies for equilibrium to be restored. For equilibrium to be restored, if my right hand side goes up, my left hand side B dash G should also go up. So B dash G must increase. That is, the marginal benefit must increase. Now we said that marginal benefit itself is a decreasing function of G. That means B double dash G is negative. As G goes up, marginal benefit decreases. When I write B double dash G is negative, it means what? I'm clarifying it. B double dash G negative means as G increases, marginal benefit falls. Now, but what do I want? When my YI increases, my whole right hand side increases. That means my left hand side must also increase to restore the equilibrium. Now, when will the marginal benefit increase? Marginal benefit is going to increase only when G falls, because you can see as G increases, marginal benefit falls. Therefore, for marginal benefit to rise, G must fall. So I can say now B double dash G is negative. Therefore, I can write for B dash G to rise, G must fall. So what do we learn? We learn that as the income of the ith individual increases, the desired level of, I can say the desired or the preferred public good level starts decreasing. G must start falling. Okay, so we can come to the lecture note and we can see this in the lecture note as well. Okay. All students can see this. And then there's a logical explanation also. We have looked at the maths of it, but you can appreciate the logical reason also behind this. You can clearly see the marginal benefit of the public good has been assumed to be a decreasing function of G. That means B double dash G is negative. So it follows that the preferred public good level is decreasing as income increases. And you can see that the reason, the logical reason behind this is what? The reason for this is that with the proportional income tax, the rich pay a higher share of the cost of the public good than the poor. Obviously, the rich have higher income than the poor. As a result, the richer people tend to pay a higher proportional income tax to the government as compared to the poor. Thus, the public good provision will disproportionately benefit the poor. That means as you become more richer, as your income increases, you will want lesser level of the public good. This is what you are getting to understand from this particular paragraph. Because as you become more richer, you will end up paying a higher proportional income tax to the government for the same public good, which will also be enjoyed by the poor. That means the proportional income tax is disproportionately benefiting the poor. It's like saying, I am a rich consumer. I also have a poor consumer along with me. Okay. The government is providing the same public good to my fellow poor consumer and to me, but I am paying a higher tax to the government just because I am rich. So what do we learn? The proportional income tax is going to disproportionately benefit the poor population, because ultimately both the rich and the poor guy are going to get the same public good. But for the same public good, the richer are paying a higher tax, proportional tax, as compared to the poor. So that simply means that as your income increases, the preferred public good level is decreasing as your income increases. You will want lesser public good when your income goes up, because you know that when your income goes up, for the same public good which your fellow poor friend is going to enjoy, you end up paying a higher tax than that. No one will be willing to pay a higher tax for the same public good which the poor candidate can also get. Okay, so we can say the usual way to resolve the disagreement. Now you can see it's a disagreement. What is the disagreement? The disagreement here is that as you keep on becoming more richer, you can see the conflict is coming now. As you are becoming more richer than before, you can pay higher taxes, but you don't want that much of public good, because the only reason behind this is that you end up paying higher tax than the poor. So the usual way to resolve this disagreement over the desired level of the public good is to choose by majority voting. The disagreement is arising because the poor people will want a higher level of the public good, but the richer people would want a lower level of the public good. Now, what will your poor friend think? The poor friend will be very happy. Why? Because he has to pay lower taxes than you, and he will get the public good, the same public good which you have got by paying higher taxes. So you can see a disagreement is arising, and this disagreement is arising across income. The poor person, or I can say the poor candidate, will be willing to enjoy more of public good provision because he has to pay relatively lower taxes than the rich candidate to avail the same public good. On the other hand, the rich candidate will be willing to have less of public good because he knows that more public good would mean that he will have to disproportionately pay higher taxes than the poor candidate. So this disagreement arises over the desired level of the public good because the richer class wants lower level of the public good so that they can avoid paying higher taxes. And the poor class would want higher level of the public good because they can get that public good by paying relatively lower taxes as compared to the richer population. Now, the solution to avoid this disagreement is what? The solution to avoid this disagreement is majority voting. We have done majority voting in game theory also. In intermediate microeconomics part 2, we have done the game theory models, where we have also done the voting model in game theory. Okay, so, and in fact, in our intermediate microeconomics part 2 course, we have even done, we even had our lectures on public goods, where we have learned the concept how majority voting can be used to make sure that the public good is efficiently provided. What should be the desired level of public good expenditure? So majority voting simply says that all consumers would prefer the level of public good to be as close to their preferred level. If I have the population consisting of H consumers, every consumer is going to have a desired level of public good. You go to every consumer will say, okay, this is the desired level of public good I want. Now, given any pair of alternatives, the consumer will vote for that level of public good which is closest to their preferred alternative. If you go to the consumer and if you ask the consumer to vote for the level of the public good, every consumer is going to speak up that level of the public good which is closest to his or her preferred alternative. So all of us know there is only one option that will satisfy this requirement. The option which is preferred by the consumer with the median income. Now, obviously, the consumer with the median income has this property that exactly half of the electorate above the median income would like less public good, and the other half below the median would like more public good. Basically, the consumer with the median income is that consumer such that half of the consumers above him are richer class, and the richer class would like less public goods. and the half of the consumers below that median consumer are the poorer class, and the poor class is going to like more public good. We just said a few minutes back, the richer class would want lesser public good, because more public good for them would mean that they end up paying disproportionately higher taxes than the poor. And the poor class would want more public good because they can get the same public good by paying relatively lower taxes as compared to the richer population. So what do we exactly learn? We learn that in order to solve this problem, one way is to look at the consumer with the median income, because exactly half of the consumers above this consumer will be the richer class, which will want less public good, and exactly half of the consumers below this critical consumer will be the poorer class, which is going to have more public good. So I can say the political equilibrium level of the public good G star is determined by the median voter. B dash G star is equal to YM by H mu, where YM is what? YM is the income of the median voter. Income of the median voter. And you can clearly see what is YM by H. What is YM by mu? YM by mu is nothing but the income of the median voter relative to the population average or population mean mu. Okay, that means if I quickly come to the whiteboard, we have finally got the political equilibrium by median voting. Okay, so I can write, if I erase this whole part of, if I erase this whole part off, I can quickly write the condition for the political equilibrium in case of the provision of the public good. So I can say the political equilibrium G star, the political equilibrium level of the public good, G star solves B dash of G star is equal to YM by H mu, where YM is the income of the median voter. Remember, the median voter is that voter such that exactly half of the population above that is the richer class, who would want lesser public good. And exactly half of the population below YM is the poor class, which is going to demand more public good. So the political equilibrium level will exactly be given by the income of the median voter. Okay, so this is my optimum condition for, or I can say the political equilibrium level of the public good G star. And you can clearly see what does YM by H4, what does YM by mu indicate? If I erase the bottom portion and if I continue further, I can write YM by mu indicates what? YM by mu indicates the median income. It indicates the median income. Or I can say it indicates the income of the median voter. Income of the median voter relative to the mean income. Relative to the mean income. Income of the median voter is how much? YM relative to the mean income. Okay, now as the inequality increases, now what does inequality increase mean? So clearly all students can see, as inequality captured by the ratio of median to mean income. The that is YM by U. So as inequality increases, captured by the ratio of the median to the mean income. So guys, if I put it in a better way, when I say inequality increases, it means what? So I can write inequality. First of all, I can write inequality is captured by the ratio of median to mean income. That is Ym by mu. Ym by mu is going to capture the inequality, the median to mean income. As Ym by mu falls, it implies inequality goes up. Guys, when your median income falls relative to the average, when the average is more than the median, when the mean is more than the median, it means inequality is going up. Okay, what is going to happen? When I say that Ym by mu falls, it implies for the balance to be restored, B dash G star must fall. And we said that B double dash G is negative. B double dash G is negative means as G increases, B dash G should fall. I want B dash G to fall. If for B dash G to fall, what should happen to G? G must rise. So I can say, I can write the following result. I can write as inequality measured by as more inequality measured by a lower ratio of Ym by mu. Okay. More inequality measured by, so I can write more inequality. I can start with saying that more inequality measured by a lower ratio of Ym by mu would lead the G star to rise. And I've explained the reason to you. When inequality goes up, that means when Ym by mu falls, when this Ym by mu falls, for the balance to be restored, B dash of G star must fall, and B dash of G star will fall only when G goes up or G star goes up. You can clearly understand from this. So that means what? It means that the marginal benefits decrease as the public good provision increases. So what do we learn? We learn that the political equilibrium level of the public good is going to increase with income inequality. I can write this result on the top. This is a very important result we have learned. So what do we learn? If I write the conclusion, I can write the political equilibrium. The political equilibrium level of the public good. The political equilibrium level of the public good G star rises with an increase in income inequality. With an increase in income inequality. As measured by a lower Ym by mu ratio. When Ym by mu falls, that means when the income of the median voter falls relative to the mean income, inequality goes up. when y m by mu falls, b dash g star must also fall, and you can see that b dash g star will fall when only when g star goes up. Since b double dash of g star is negative, the sign of b double dash g star is negative. Okay, since b double dash g star is negative, for b dash g star to fall, g star must rise. So you can clearly see the political equilibrium level of the public good g star will rise with an increase in income inequality as measured by the lower ym by mu ratio. So what do we learn? We learn that as the income inequality goes up in the economy, the desired political level of the public good G star is going to rise. That's a very important result. Okay, so hoping all students have understood this model. If I come back to the lecture note, it was indeed a very important model discussing the size of the public good. The political model is one of the most important models we had done. And you can clearly see I've discussed it in the paragraph as well. Since the marginal benefits decrease as the public good provision increases, this line means what? This line means that B double dash G is negative. The political equilibrium level of the public good increases with income inequality, which is measured by the ratio of median to mean income. More inequality as measured by a lower ratio of median to mean income would lead the decisive median voter to require more public spending. The entire paragraph is telling us that as ym by mu goes up, let me correct myself, as ym by mu goes down, as ym by mu goes down, which means inequality going up, b dash g star must also go down, and for b dash g star to go down, g star must rise. That means the level of the public good desired by the median voter is going to go up. Another way of saying it requires more public spending. The decisive median voter will require more public spending. Okay, so hoping all students have understood the political model, where we have seen that first of all, that there is a conflict in the public preferences. Okay, if I quickly sum up, we started with saying in the political model that there is a conflict in the public preferences. Why? Because those who wish to have higher expenditure and those who wish to limit the burden of the taxes, they are two conflicting things. If you want to have higher public expenditure, for that you need to pay higher taxes to the government. But you can see there's a conflict in public preferences. You want to pay lower taxes to the government, but you want the government to do more expenditure for you. So we looked at the microeconomics of this model. Okay, we built up the utility function of the ith consumer. Okay, and we did the optimization. And what we had learned was that as income goes up, this is what we had learned. Okay. First of all, we had learned this condition, which simply tells us that the optimum level of the public good relates the marginal benefit exactly equal to the marginal cost. And then we had learned that the quantity of the public good demanded by the consumer is going to depend on its income relative to the mean. Okay. And then we had looked at the properties of the marginal benefit function. We said that the marginal benefit is positive, but it is increasing at a decreasing rate. That means it's concave. And then we had said that the desired or the preferred public good level is going to decrease as income goes up. Mathematically also, we are all convinced with that, given the equations of optimization. And logically also, we know that as income goes up, that means as you become more richer, you are going to pay disproportionately higher taxes for the same public good enjoyed by your fellow poor friend. That means as income goes up, you will demand less of, you will prefer less of public good. On the other hand, as you become more poorer, you will prefer more of public good because you will be paying disproportionately lower taxes and enjoying the same public good as your fellow rich friend. Okay, and then we had seen that in order to solve this disagreement across the income class, we can look at majority voting. If you go by majority voting, you go to every consumer is going to prefer that level of public good which is nearest to his preferred level. So the solution to this problem is you pick up that particular consumer, you pick up the median voter. The median voter is that consumer who has a property that exactly half of the consumers above this median consumer are rich consumers who prefer less public good. Exactly half of the consumers below this critical consumer are poor consumers who prefer more of public good. So you pick up the median consumer, you get this condition. This is the optimum political equilibrium G star. Okay. And then what we have learned is that in the economy, as inequality goes up, captured by a fall in YM by mu ratio, it is going to cause your spending by the median voter to rise. That means G star is going to rise. So these are all the important terms we have learned in this model. And then we quickly look at the last thing in this lecture, after which we stop, the ratchet effect. Okay, so now this is also very interesting. So models of the ratchet effect assume that preferences of the government is to spend money. In contrast, it is assumed that the public does not want to pay taxes. You can clearly see the government prefers to spend more money, but the public does not prefer to pay higher taxes. So higher spending can only come from taxes. So by implication, the public partially resists this. They do not get some benefits from expenditure. So you can clearly see the two competing objectives are moderated by the fact that the government desires re-election. Okay, the government is going to prefer to spend more money on public expenditure. The public, on the other hand, does not want to pay taxes. Okay, but at the same time, you understand this, the public is going to partially resist this because they also get some benefit from expenditure. So if you look at the public's point of view, there are two things which are moving in opposite direction. The public is not willing to pay higher taxes, but at the same time, the public also knows that if we pay higher taxes, the government is going to provide the public good, which is going to give us benefits. So the two competing objectives are moderated by the fact that the governments desire re-election. This makes it necessary for the government to take some account of the public's preferences. The equilibrium level of the public sector expenditure is determined by the balance between these competing forces. What are the competing forces? The public does not want to pay higher taxes. Okay, because the public is paying them ultimately from their income only. But at the same time, the public also knows that paying more taxes would mean the government spending more on public expenditure, which is ultimately going to benefit the consumers only. So these are two competing forces. In the absence of any exogenous change or changes in the preferences, the level of expenditure will remain relatively constant. So ratchet effect is telling us that the public expenditure is neither going to rise nor fall. It's going to be fairly constant. Because if you look at the public, there are two competing forces the public is facing. They do not want to pay higher taxes, but they also know that paying higher taxes would mean more expenditure by the government on public, which in turn is ultimately going to benefit the public. So these two competing forces on these two competing forces from the point of view of the public will cause the expenditure by the government to remain relatively constant. Okay, so during the periods of significant upheaval such as the wartime situation, the normal economic activity is disrupted. Further, the equilibrium between the government and the taxpayer becomes suspended. So ratchet models argue that the wartime permits the government to raise expenditure with the consent of taxpayers on the understating that this is necessary to meet the exceptional needs that have risen. However, the final aspect of the argument is that the level of expenditure does not fall back to its original level after the period of upheaval. Okay, so what are the reasons for this? You can clearly see that when you have a war situation, okay, during the periods of wartime, all of us know that the normal economic activities, they become disrupted. So the equilibrium between the government and the taxpayers is going to become suspended. So the ratchet model will argue that the wartime is going to permit the government to raise expenditure a war situation will require the government to increase its expenditure, and increasing expenditure is going to require more taxes from the taxpayers, because the government is going to finance its expenditure during the war only by taxes, collecting taxes. Okay, so however, the final aspect of the ratchet model argument is that the level of expenditure does not fall back to its original level after the period of upheaval. That means after the war time is over, the expenditure of the government is not going to fall back to its original level. Why? The taxpayers become accustomed to the higher level of expenditure and perceive this as the norm. Debts incurred during the period of upheaval have to be paid off later. That means the government cannot reduce its expenditure back after the war. During the wartime, when the government has raised its expenditure, it will have to continue to remain at high level of expenditure. Why? Because during the wartime, when the government is spending more, the taxpayers, which means the public, becomes accustomed to it. So if after the war, if the government lowers its expenditure, it is going to be a politically difficult decision, because the taxpayers or the public is now becoming accustomed or habitual to the government spending more. If after the war, the government starts spending less, it sends a bad signal to the public. Second reason is that during the war, the government has accumulated more debt. In order to repay the debt after the war, the government has to make sure that it's continuing with that level of expenditure. It's not reducing it. Okay, and promises made by the government to the taxpayers during the periods of upheaval then have to be met. So these can jointly be termed the ratchet effect that sustains a higher level of spending. That means all these three points are telling us what? These three points are telling us that during the abnormal situations like the war period, when the economic activity gets disrupted, the government has to raise its expenditure by collecting more taxes. But then after this period of upheaval or the war situation is over, the government cannot reduce its level of expenditure. The government will have to maintain sustained high expenditure, because the taxpayers become habitual to the government spending more. The government, the debts which are incurred during the period of upheaval have to be paid off later. Okay, so the government spending is going to go up. After the war situation, also the government spending is going to go up, because the government has to repay the debts it accumulated during the war period. And whatever promises were made by the government to the taxpayers during the period of war, they will also have to be met. Okay, so the ratchet effect is going to tell you that there's a higher level of expenditure which will continue even after the period of upheaval. Finally, there may occur an inspection effect, often after an upheaval, whereby the taxpayers and the government reconsider their positions and priorities. The discovery of previously unnoticed needs then provides further justification for higher public sector spending. Okay, if the government and the public come to notice that there were a lot of things which went unnoticed, the government couldn't spend on them during the war period, now the government has to spend on them. That means it will lead to an even higher public sector spending. This is called the inspection effect. Inspection effect means that after the war situation is over, or after the upheaval situation is over, the taxpayers and the government will sit together and they are going to reconsider their priorities. Now the government might come to the picture that during the war period, we could have spent a lot of money on health and infrastructure, but we couldn't spend it. So after the war is over, now in order to make sure that later, if some other war comes up, we should be ready with good health and infrastructure facilities. So the government is now going to start spending on health and infrastructure, which is going to further lead to higher public sector spending. So when the government is going to do inspection, and when the government is going to realize that there were some areas during the periods of upheaval where we were not spending up to the optimum amount, so now they'll start spending more on those particular areas, which is going to further increase public sector spending. So this is called the ratchet effect. Okay. So if I sum up ratchet effect in two lines, what is it telling us? It is telling us that during the periods of upheaval, in our case, the war situation, the example which we have taken, when the government raises its expenditure by collecting more taxes, then even after the periods of upheaval are over, it will lead to a sustained increase in government spending. The government cannot say that now the war is over, let us start spending less. No. The level of government spending during the war period went up. It's going to continue to remain high even after the war or the period of upheaval. And there are three reasons, three good reasons for saying this. Reason one, reason two, and reason three. Okay, so students, this is where I intend to stop in this particular lecture. Okay, it was a very interesting lecture where the objective was to discuss with all students the political model for the provision of the public good, and we have looked at the ratchet effect. Now, in the next lecture, we are going to look at the bureaucracy model. In the next lecture of public economics, we are going to look at the bureaucracy model. It's again a very interesting model. Okay, so I stop in this lecture. I hope all students have enjoyed this lecture. Any doubt, you can unmute your mic and ask, or call up, or mail me your doubts at divineschoolofeconomics@gmail.com. So this is where I stop in this lecture.